So welcome to the vote. I'm here with Roger Hinton, who was Honorary Secretary of the Regency Society. Welcome to the vote, Roger.
Thank you.
Should we just start off by talking about the Regency Society, its background and the role it's had in the city for a number of years now?
Yeah, sure. The first thing I always say when I'm talking about the Regency Society is that the name is misleading, but we're stuck with it, so perhaps I could just explain that. It was founded in 1945, at the end of the Second World War, and it was founded on the back of a big campaign to save the Regency architecture on Brighton seafront, particularly Brunswick Square, Brunswick Terraces. There was a plan to knock all that down and build blocks of flats.
Well, you just can't imagine that.
Well, we can't now, but at that time, that was being proposed.
Yeah.
And from there, it has grown. But I think that the other important thing to emphasise is that we're not just interested in the history of the city. We are interested in that. But we're also interested in the future of the city. And so we spend a lot of time looking at development proposals for new buildings and any other schemes like Valley Gardens and so on, any big proposals for the city, we will look at and perhaps express an opinion on.
Yeah, and what are the key, you've got some jewels in the crown, haven't you, in terms of some of the architecture which you kind of represent. So you said Brunswick Square, but we've got Sussex Square, we've got Lewis Crescent.
I'll declare an interest. I live in Regency Square.
Yeah.
But unfortunately, Regency Square, in spite of its name, is not really the jewel in the crown because, as you probably know, it was developed as a car park.
Yes.
And it now has a car park underneath it, which means the gardens are not exactly as they should be.
Yes.
If you go along to the west, you come to Brunswick Square. Now, that has been protected far better.
Yes.
And I would say that there are two jewels in the crown, and Brunswick Square is one of them. And there the gardens are much as they would always have been.
Yes.
And if we go up to the other end of the city, in Kemp Town, you have Lewis Crescent and Sussex Square. And that, I think, is the other jewel in the crown in terms of seafront architecture. And let's add another one, just so in case anybody thinks I've forgotten it, and that's the Royal Pavilion, of course, which is the crown, really.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah.
But there's a number, we've got a lot of grade one and grade two listed buildings in Brighton. Are we overrepresented on, you know, in terms of the average amount of listed buildings in Brighton?
Because I don't think we're overrepresented, right. No. I think that a lot these buildings are listed over time when people come to the conclusion that they need to be protected.
Yes.
And no, I think...
Is there anything currently that should be protected, you think, that currently isn't in the city?
At the moment, our concerns are not to do with particular buildings that need protecting. I mean, who knows, tomorrow there might be a proposal to demolish something important, but at the moment, our concerns are with big new development proposals which are underway.
Yes.
For example, at Brighton Marina, there's a proposal for a housing development at the west end of Brighton Marina, which will actually be built on a platform out over the water.
Yes, yeah.
And that's going to provide 1,000 new apartments if it goes ahead. The city plan, which is what the planners look at when they want to know what should happen, the city plan says that that's a good location for housing, and the city plan says we need a lot more housing, 13,000 new homes over the next few years. So, you know, there's a lot going for this scheme in that it will help implement the city plan. But then when you look at the designs for it, and the developers have produced lots of good illustrations to show exactly what it will look like and what the before and after views will be from various points in the city. And it is huge.
Yes.
It's not as tall. There was a previous scheme, which you probably remember, which included a 40-storey tower. And that did get permission, but it never went ahead.
Yeah.
This one...
New developer,
different developer, and it involves a smaller tower, still 28 storeys, but considerably lower. And it's interesting why they've stopped at 28. I think the reason they've stopped at 28 is that if you build above 28, a whole lot of new additional regulations come in.
Yes.
And that adds to cost.
Yes.
So they're trying to keep the cost down. And here's another good thing about this scheme. They're trying to keep the cost down because they want the apartments that they build to be available to ordinary people who live in Brighton and Hove. They don't want them to be...
So you're in favour of it, are you?
No, I'm not. I'm giving you the pros at the moment. Okay. But, you know, we've discussed it at great length in the society. And we've met with the developer and the architect and so on. And we think there's a lot going for it. And I've mentioned a couple of the things.
Yes.
But ultimately, we think they're trying to cram too much onto the site. And it's going to be very tall buildings, very close together, which means the wind, when they get a bit of wind at the marina, you know, the wind will whistle through between the buildings. People on the lower floors will have very poor views. And the views from important places like Lewis Crescent, but all along the coast, you know. I cycled into Brighton yesterday from Rottingdean, and you can see the marina, obviously, for a lot of the way, and you can see beyond the marina to the pier and even as far as Worthing. Now, if this building goes ahead, those views will be blocked, will be lost.
Yes,
and
yeah.
New views will come into their place. Who knows? People might like the new views, but a lot of people like the old views. And so, on balance, the Regency Society has objected, and we've submitted our views to the planning committee.
Yeah. And so what is the role of the society in general then? So, as you were saying, you kind of scrutinise building proposals now, but you still have that role of protecting, you know, what we've been left with in Brighton in terms
yeah.
of the
yes.
key architecture.
If there was a proposal to demolish Brunswick Square, then we would be leading the campaign to prevent that.
Which is unlikely.
But as you just said, it is not particularly likely. And if all we did was to exist, was to wait for that to happen, you know, we wouldn't exist because we'd get bored.
Yeah.
I mean, personally, I'm interested, and the society as well is interested, in the future of the city.
Yes.
And, for example, when the city plan was written a few years ago, we got involved in that. We, you know, they have a consultation, and we went to a number of meetings, and we had our say. And we ended up being fairly supportive of the city plan, and particularly of the need for the 13,000 additional homes. The forecast, when that plan was written, the forecast was that Brighton and Hove would, over the next 10 years or so, need 25,000, something like that, additional homes.
Yeah.
Because of the growth of population, people moving in and so on. And the council was set the challenge of trying to show where they could put 25,000 new homes. And they couldn't find it. They couldn't find the space for 25,000 new homes. And they came forward with a scheme, I forget what the first figure was, something like 10,000. And the government inspector, whose job it was to approve or not
yes.
approve the
yeah.
plan, said, you're going to have to go back and look down every rabbit hole to find some more space. So they did, and what they came up with was controversial. They identified a number of fringe sites on the edge of the city.
Yes.
Which were greenfield sites, but they were on the edge of the city. And
Coldean's one of them, isn't it? Which is just
yeah,
got
Coldean is
got planning approval
just got
2 weeks
approval
ago.
For council flats.
Total Valley's the big one.
Total Valley is the big one, that's
yeah.
right, yeah. But there were quite a few. And that took the figure up to the present figure of 13,000. And
yes.
the inspector then said, yeah, okay, well, we know that in theory, Brighton and Hove is going to need a lot more than that, but we've also know that it's not going to be possible to find that space. So 13,000 is the figure.
Yes.
And it's a challenge to find it.
I can't see them increasing that dramatically over the coming years, unless they do, you know, what's going on, like what's going on at the marina, build out into the sea maybe, or build upwards. There's only two ways. Or
yeah.
build on the South Downs.
And the marina scheme is doing both those things. It's
yes.
building up and it's building out
yeah.
over the water.
Yeah. So maybe we can touch upon that in the second half about, you know, how we address the housing needs. Just before we finish the first half, how does someone join the Regency Society? You've got a website. And
the website is regencysociety.org.
Yeah.
So hopefully people can remember that, but yes. I'll say it again, regencysociety.org.
Yes.
There's an application form there. And if you become a member, then obviously we keep the members informed about what the society is doing, but also what is happening in the city. So this issue about the marina development,
yep.
There was an article about that in this month's members update.
Great. Okay, we'll leave it there for now. Join us for the second half. We'll be talking to Roger about more about some of the controversial planning approaches in Brighton and also more about the society. So welcome back to The Vote. I'm here with Roger Hinton from the Regency Society, Honorary Secretary. Just before we start off again, you were previously chairman, I think, of the Society, weren't you, for a number of years?
Yeah, 6 years, I was chair. Yeah.
What happened during that time? Were there any big decisions there? What period did that cover?
I think the thing which I found most interesting and which I think is probably of great importance to the city is that we got involved in discussions with the council and other people about the proposed development at Black Rock.
Yes, yeah.
Which is linked to the sale of the Brighton Centre, the conference centre.
Yes.
The starting point for that is something which I don't think anybody would disagree with, which is that the Brighton Centre is out of date, it's past its sell-by date. It's not able to attract the big shows which people like these days, and it's not meeting the need. So we need a new venue in the city. Now the council's answer to that is to say, right, well, we own some land at Black Rock. That would be a good place to build a bigger conference centre. And if we do that, we can then sell the site where the Brighton Centre is, in the centre of the city. And in fact, they've got a buyer, who that is the owners of Churchill Square, a company called Standard Life Aberdeen, yeah. Who are willing
Massive
to buy
company.
It. Yeah, they're willing to buy it, and they already own the King's West. So having bought that and owning the King's West, they will be able to extend Churchill Square down to the King's Road. So that's called the waterfront project,
yes.
The development of Churchill Square and the development of a venue at Black Rock. Now, the question you want to ask me is it a good idea? And my answer is, I don't know whether it's a good idea
yeah.
or not. Because at the moment, there are big question marks over it. And although the council is already quite a way down the road with this, they've signed what's called a conditional land agreement with Standard Life Aberdeen, which basically says that if they can get planning permission for Black Rock and if they can get planning permission for Churchill Square, then the deal will go ahead.
Yeah.
So they are committed to that extent.
Yes.
But when you ask the obvious questions, they don't have answers. And the obvious questions, as far as the Regency Society is concerned, are two. First one is, sorry, three. The first one is, how can you fit a 10,000 seat venue and everything that goes with it onto the Black Rock site? Now, I was in Liverpool a few weeks ago, and I went and looked at their waterfront conference
yeah.
venue. Huge.
It's fairly new, isn't it?
It's new, and it's yeah. huge. And the idea that you could fit something of that scale onto Black Rock, I remain to be convinced. But
yes.
who knows? A good
and
architect.
Parking.
Well, yeah, that's right. Part of it, it's not just the building. It's everything that goes with the building.
It's the car park behind Brighton Centre,
yeah.
of course. So.
Which brings me to the second point, which is, how do you get people there and back? Some people will want to come by car, so parking will be an issue. Some people might want to come by bus. There aren't many buses to go to Black Rock as such. There are some that go into the marina. Maybe people talk about replacing Vokes Railway with a modern light railway system, at which point all the supporters of Vokes Railway jump up and down, rightly so,
yes.
because it's a historic piece of the city's
yes.
heritage. So that's the second problem, transport and getting people there. And the council doesn't have an answer to that either. And the third one, which of course is a particular concern to the Regency Society, is what will the impact be on the important heritage assets above that site, namely Sussex Square and Lewis Crescent.
Yes.
The views are already being impacted by developments at the marina, as we've just discussed.
Yes.
This new building on Black Rock will be even nearer. And again, we don't really know how they're going to get a building onto that site that doesn't completely ruin the views from and towards those heritage buildings. Now,
and you've got the Valley Gardens proposal, which there'll be one-way traffic along.
There will be one-way traffic along the Diver Drive. That's right.
Makes it even
yeah.
more complicated.
Which incidentally gives me an opportunity to mention one of the other big projects at the moment in Brighton, which is to restore the Madeira arches, which are in
yes.
terrible condition. The Regency Society made a contribution to the crowdfunding campaign that went on a while ago, if you remember.
Yes.
And we're very keen to see that. And we've got one of our trustees, who's a heritage architect, is our representative on the consultative panel. And the council are doing a good job there. I mean, they haven't found the solution, but it's a big problem, and they're working hard to find a solution
yes.
to it.
Yeah.
Whereas coming back to the waterfront project in Black Rock, what they say, if you ask them the questions that I just raised, is, well, all those will be considered when the planning application is put in. And what concerns me is that the planning application will be decided by Brighton and Hove City Planning Committee. And the development is one that has been proposed by Brighton and Hove City Council.
Yes, yeah.
There seems to be a conflict of interest there.
So what would your solution be then? Because we've both agreed that Brighton Centre is probably not fit for purpose. I mean, I know the Labour Party conference is going here, so we do have major conferences taking place here, but maybe not the exhibitions, the big exhibitions and you know, other big kind of conferences, which kind of require more space than the...
I don't know about exhibitions, because the main exhibition halls in Brighton are behind the Metropole Hotel. They're
yes.
part of the Metropole Hotel.
Yeah.
And they're very little used. In fact, I think there were plans to replace them with housing. But the solution... I don't have a solution. I'm not a town planner. I'm not an architect. But I think that alternative options should be put forward. There's a basic principle when you're making a big decision. You don't find one answer and then go for it. You look for a number of different solutions to the problem.
Yes.
Black Rock is one which the Regency Society doesn't support at the moment, because we remain to be convinced that it could possibly work. But we also remain to be convinced that there aren't solutions which would involve development on the existing site.
Yes.
There's a big site there. If you take the Brighton Centre and King's West together, and it needs developing.
Yes.
So I think that, yes, Churchill Square can be expanded, and that will bring Standard Life Aberdeen on board, but perhaps it can be expanded in a way which isn't just more shops. And to be fair, that's what Standard Life Aberdeen are talking about. They want it to be a destination rather than just a shopping mall. And maybe one of the things in this destination would be a conference venue.
Yes.
But a conference venue which is up to modern day standards.
Yes. Coming back to the Madeira Terraces, why do you think that successive councils of all political colours have let that get into such a state of disrepair?
I think anybody who knows, who's a property owner, would know the answer to that. And that is that you see something, oh, look, a bit of water coming in there. Yeah, okay, must do something about that. And then something else happens. Oh, yeah, I've got to do something about that. And, you know, you intend to do something about it, but actually we're a bit short of cash at the moment
and
a bit short of time, and they don't get round to it. They don't think about it. And, you know, the things are still standing. They're wonderful, and they're still standing. But at last the council has recognised that major work is done.
Yes.
And it's true. Had the council done better maintenance over the years, then they would not have this big problem now. But you have a choice with property. You either let it run down and then spend a lot of money on it, or you maintain it well
yes.
throughout its life. Obviously, the second is the better approach.
Yes.
But when you're running a local authority, you have huge calls on your finances, and you know, you can't always do it the way you ideally would like to.
So I know the council's going to provide some of the money. we've spoken to Jack Zatkins as well from the Save Madeira Terraces campaign. So what else can be done? Because it's going to take a few £ million, isn't it, to restore all of the arches?
Yes.
So lottery funding's one solution, isn't it?
The lottery funding is certainly a potential solution, and the crowdfunding, which we contributed to and lots of other people did as well, was great. But it produced £500,000, and as you say, it's going to be several million pounds is the cost. And at the moment, the lottery fund is not playing ball. Not because they don't think it's a great scheme that needs to be carried out, but just because they've got too many claims on there, they've got limited resources as well.
Yes.
So I'm sure the council will be continuing to apply, because when they've had the refusal from previous applications, I think they've also been told exactly what I just said, that it's a good scheme, it was a good application. One of the reasons it was a good application was because of the crowdfunding, which demonstrates the public support for it, and that's one of the main things the Lottery Fund will look at when they're making decisions.
So just very shortly, what's the future for the society? Is there anything coming up in the coming few months with the new council?
Every month we look at the planning applications we don't know what's going to come up. But there is one thing which is a sort of elephant in the room, if you like, and that's the swimming pool out in Hove.
Yes. Yeah. So that'd be the King Alfred.
The King Alfred, thank you.
Yeah. And we can save discussion that for another day, I think. So
there'll certainly be a discussion when the plans come forward.
And we'll come back when that plan application is put forward.
Great.
As well. So thanks for coming in, Roger, and all the best with the society. And we'll catch up again soon. Thanks a lot.